Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Additional VHDL Topics, Loop Statements. So in addition to those if statements and case statements, we have these two separate types of loop statements. And up front, you got to kind of differentiate between them. First off is a for loop. The other one's a while loop. And the analogy I like to use to describe the difference between fors and whiles harkens back to the bad old days when your parents have suddenly decided that you are going to be becoming a contributing member to the family. And at fourth grade, they give you an axe and push you out into a blizzard, and they say this logical equation: stack and split, or we will kill you. So you go out into the blizzard and you stack and split, or split and stack firewood, based on two conditions. Basically, they're going to give you a specified number of pieces you have to stack. Stack 1,000 pieces before you can come in. Or they're going to give you a task. Stack it and split it until the pile equals zero. Okay, and that's the difference between a for loop and a while loop. A for loop is you're going to execute a task a specific number of times. Split and stack 1,000 pieces. Whereas a while loop, you're going to execute that task until that pile is zero. Okay, basically until some condition occurs. They're very similar, but as far as the construction of these things go, but it's two totally different means of describing. A for loop is a specified number, whereas a while, it's going to keep on executing it, and keep on executing it, and keep on executing it until that condition is satisfied. And now think of, you know, a potentially tricky situation with a while loop. What if that condition is never satisfied? That loop will continue to run. What if the condition is already satisfied before you enter the loop? Okay, that loop will never run, whereas a for loop is going to execute that specific number of times. Let's talk about the while loop real quick. And then we'll go into the for loop. We're going to use the for loop a little bit more, but I just want to cover the while loop real quick. Okay, so while loop, like I said, is you're going to determine an exit point, and that exit point could potentially be some condition or a Boolean statement. Okay, so here's the general format of a while loop. It's occurring, again, within a process. You could potentially put some declarations for variables or components or internal signals to that process, and then we're going to go ahead and begin it, and then we're going to end it. In between that begin and end for the process statement, we're going to say while the exit point loop, and then we're going to execute that expression until the exit point is satisfied. So that's a key thing to understand. When that Boolean expression is evaluated true, that's the point which it exits the loop. Super quick introduction to the while loop. Let's actually talk a little bit more in depth about the for loop, because this is one you're going to be using a little bit more often, and we'll be using it in the lab this week. So I wrote the general format for a for loop on the left, but let's not pay attention to that right now until you just pay attention to this. In its very, very general terms, a for loop has kind of three conditions to it. You're going to have a start value, and then you're going to have a stop value. And every single time you go through the loop, you're going to increment the identifier associated with those start and stop values, or decrement it. Okay, when I say increment or decrement, I could start at 1 and stop at 8, and I would have to increment that identifier 1 every single time I go through the loop to do it 8 times. Whereas I could potentially start at 8 and stop at 1 and decrement that thing every time I go through the loop and still do the same number of loops. Okay, so you can have a start higher than the stop, or you can have a start lower than the stop, and those identifiers either increment or decrement. VHDL specifics, however, what you've got is over here on the left. Again, what is it? It's a process. There's a certain sensitivity list that goes with it. I could potentially declare some variables for use within that process statement. I'm going to begin the process statement, and then I'm going to end the process statement. The for loop appears within that begin to end in the process. For, and I just kind of ignore what I'm talking about. Well, don't ignore what I'm talking about. Ignore this identifier for a second. For the identifier in our start position to our end position. Loop. Every time you enter the loop, do this expression. And if your end is bigger than your start, it increments. If your end is smaller than your start, your start is bigger than your end, you got to go ahead and say down to end. It's going to decrement that identifier. What I'm saying in the identifier is it's some usable counter. And you can call it whatever you want to. But stylistically, people typically wear hats on their heads rather than their feet. Most identifiers, just people just call it I, for identifier in this loop. And let's say it's 3 down to 0. Okay, so the first time you go through the loop, I is 3. Second time you go through the loop, I is 2. Third time you go through the loop, I is 1. Fourth time you go through the loop, I is 0. And what's really cool is you can use I in that expression to potentially address positions within a standard logic vector. For example, x3 the first time through, x2 the first time through, x1 for the first time through, x0 for the fourth time through. So it's a pretty neat idea, the fact that you can potentially use that identifier within those expressions. And again, that's our start and that's our stop. So let's just try an example of a for loop. And what we're going to do is do one of the common functions of combinational logic, namely a parity generator. Okay, if you remember right, a parity generator is checking for odd or even number of ones. So let's do a parity generator for 8 bits. Let's call it x, this is standard logic, 7 down to 0. We want to go ahead and generate an odd parity bit and an even parity bit. So if there's an odd number of ones, we're going to go ahead and generate that odd parity bit. If there's an even number of ones, we're going to go ahead and tell it, okay, hey, it is even. Okay, and that's obviously, those conditions can never simultaneously exist. So here's an example. X happens to be 1100011. Okay, so how many ones are there? There are 5 ones. So odd should go high. Okay, it is an odd number of ones. What should even be? It should be 0. And if you think about it, even is not odd. Okay, we have already discussed though, however, in our previous discussion about variables, we cannot define an output as a function of another output. So I could not write the expression even is assigned not odd. Okay, so I can't do that. I could potentially make use of a variable. So now additionally too, is just think about this. What is an odd parity generator? It's basically taking the exclusive OR of these guys, then taking the exclusive OR of that, then taking the exclusive OR of that, and so on and so forth and so on and so forth. And that is the final bit there. Look at what I've just created. It's kind of a loop structure. It's a for loop. For how many times? Well, how many bit positions does X have? There's a special function that I'm actually going to be using, and it's called tick length. Okay, so when I put, so let's say I've defined X as a standard logic vector, X7 down to 0, if I say X tick length, what that means is going to generate a number that is the length of that bit of that standard logic vector. What is the length of something that has 8 bits? The answer is 8. This is what I'm going to create here is a for loop that I could extend this out to potentially to a 16-bit position or a 32-bit position or a 64-bit array. Okay, so I'm making a pretty usable VHDL component, and let's call it a parity generator. Okay, so here I am inside the IC Project Navigator. I have created an entity, which I'm calling Parity Gen VHDL. Its ports are, it's got an X input that's 7 down to 0, output odd, it will go high if it's odd, even, output even, it will go high if it's even, so even number of ones. So what I'm going to do is I've got my architecture, I'm going to begin my architecture, end my architecture. I'm going to have a process. What is its sensitivity list? Well, it's obviously dependent upon the input X. I'm going to define a variable V. Variable V is something I could potentially go ahead and get rid of that problem where I'm trying to define even as not odd. Okay, because I remember I cannot define an output as a function of an output. Okay, so I could potentially use a variable in there. Additionally, we're going to make use of this variable to do something really cool. I'm going to go ahead and begin my process statement. I'm going to declare the variable V, excuse me, initialize the variable V, which I've already declared up here. I'm going to initialize it as 0. Why? Because basically what I'm going to do is do a looped exclusive OR. Now here I'm going to do is my for loop, for I, my identifier I. I'm starting at 0, and I'm going to X tick length minus 1. Why minus 1? Because tick length of X, this thing will return 8 because it's 7 down to 0, but I want to go from 0 to 7. What I'm doing is I'm going through this thing 8 times, but I'm incrementing I from 0 to 7. Why? Because check this out. The variable V is assigned the first initial value of V, which we remember, right, is 0. Exclusive ORed with XI. Okay, so what is XI means? What I'm using is I'm using that identifier within the loop. The first time I go through the loop, what's my start value? It's 0. So 0 exclusive OR X 0. Next time I go through the loop, I increment I to 1. And then what I do is I say V, which was the previous value of V, is now exclusive ORed with X1. And I store that value to V. Again, that variable is continually being updated. Again, showing you not only that I can provide output as a function of another output, but I'm continually updating this variable. Whereas a signal, if you remember right, X is going to be odd or even, they're only defined at the end of the process statement. A variable is continually updated throughout that. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go for x1, x2, x3, all the way up to x7. And I'm going to have a final value v. And once I get to that x tick length minus 1, i.e. 7, I'm going to stop. Odd is assigned v. Even is assigned not v. At this point, I end the process, and those signals are assigned to odd and even. And if I put in an 8-bit number on my particular board here that has an odd number of ones, the odd light should go high or light up, and the even light should stay off. And if I put in an 8-bit combination of ones that happens to be even, the odd light should stay off and the even light should go on. Now, one more thing about this here is notice I've designed this using a top-level design here. Here's my top-level design. Again, what is a top-level design? All it is I've got an entity based upon that particular board or device that I'm using. In this particular case, I'm using a Spartan 3E, and it's on a development board that has a certain input and output combinations based on a user constraints file, a UCF file, and I'm just calling my inputs switches. I'm calling my outputs LEDs. How do I use a top level? Well, it's basically I declare a component. Which component do I declare? Well, that single program that I'm using there. And then all I do is in the architecture statement, I instantiate the component, port map it up to the specific inputs and outputs that I want based on that device, and let it rip. So if you go ahead and try this out with your particular device here, if you put in an odd number of ones, you should go ahead and have that odd light up, and the even light should stay off. This concludes the for loop and while loop statements.